such bullshit, man. This is bullshit.
I don't want to put the instant replay in the fucking game.
Oh, so you can see
this bullshit. This is the most heated you've ever been in BS Gold, and it's over the mattress.
I feel very strongly about this subject.
Well, I'm telling you,
I haven't slept in 11 months.
I'm not allowed to have a Twitter account.
This is the Conn Smythe Trophy winner. I don't think he's...
He wasn't yet. Every time we play this game, we're basically in a time machine.
I'm giving this a 10.
10?
I'm giving it a 10. I think
there's no way it's a 10. We've never seen a 10.
This has got to be a 10.
Are you changing your baby on top of the microphone or what?
No, I had to take all the stuff off the baby's bed, you asshole.
Wait, you're recording this on your baby's bed?
There's a bed in the baby's room. I'm recording it in that room because Rachel and the baby are napping in our bedroom.
Oh, well.
We got a family, dude.
That's frightening, man.
We have to do these things. Have you guys been watching the Devil's Flyers by chance?
No, it's what, 2-2 in the second?
It is.
Come on, Devils.
I'm very excited about this series.
Why do you like the Devils so much? I never asked you that.
Because that podcast I listened to, the Kevin Smith thing, Puck Nuts and Tell 'em Steve Dave, they're Devils fans, so I've been like listening about them for 2 years now.
Really? Like, you that religiously listen?
Yeah, I've listened to every episode. Same reason I'm a fan of the Penguins and the Steelers, because I had to listen to your ass talk about them for about 2 years. Every weekend, it was like another, you know, sit down on the couch and talk about why you're depressed. Well, you know, we got Dennis Dixon going out there, and, you know, he sucks. He sucks. We got no offensive line.
That's an interesting mix of, like, Pittsburgh and Alabama in that accent.
Gotta go down to Permane's and get me a sandwich.
Yeah. Now that you guys got all that penguin talk out of your system last time we tried, we could do a quick...
Oh, no. I didn't get it all out of my system. I don't know about you, Rez.
You're telling me after the 20 minutes you spent talking about Dan Bylsma, there's still something in there?
Well, you're the one that brought up Bylsma. Hello, everyone. Welcome to BS Goals. And it's been a long time, hasn't it, Jason?
It must be about 4 months.
Oh, at least. And I got to say that the only reason that I am coming out of the woodwork here to record a new podcast is because of the massive bullshit goal that happened in Game 1 of the Penguins Flyers series, which I'm going to go out there on the limb and say that fucking goal... That first goal by Briere is the only reason why the Penguins lost that series.
Well, do you want to introduce our special guests so you two Penguins fans can rehash it?
Right, so we can get all Homer together. tonight we have a special guest, another fellow Pittsburgh native, beaming here live from Los Angeles, our good friend Rez. Welcome, Rez.
Thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
Now, Matt, if I could jump in real quick, I was at the time, I mean, it was only 5 games, but I was very busy with the Sharks-Blues series.
Uh-huh.
Could you maybe recap this bullshit goal that you speak of? Because you actually never brought this goal up to me before. I don't think I caught it.
You didn't catch the very first Flyers goal in the Penguins series.
Well, it was hard to catch it, considering I think when I switched over to the first game, it was already something like 6-5 or something. so I think that goal may have gotten lost in the 60 goals that were scored in the series.
Okay, so let me set the stage for you. The Pens are up 3-0. I think we went into the locker room 3-0. Is that right, Rez?
I believe so, yes.
Second period, at some point in the second period... Someone sends a stretch pass up the ice to Dan Briere, who is at least 8 feet offsides, and the linesman doesn't call it, and he swoops in alone on Fleury and top shelves him.
Could not be handled by Vitale. Pushed on back, and it's a chance around in front for Briere. He scores! Danny Briere!
Now, that game, if you remember, was decided, it was like the closest game of the series, pretty much. It was decided in overtime, and the Flyers won 4-3. At that point in the game, it was 3-0 Pittsburgh, And then the Flyers scored four unanswered goals to go on and win that and eventually the series. And the goal was clearly bullshit. I mean, even Pierre McGuire was down on the ice level, you know, completely saying that the linesman had muffed the call. But I think what it really did was not so much hurt the... Well, I'd say it 50-50 hurt the Penguins' psyche as to, like, oh, shit, how did we give up a three-goal lead and give up four unanswered goals? But it also, you know, put the Flyers in this mindset of, oh, we can overcome any fucking deficit. And then they went on to win game two after being down by another two-goal deficit. And then game three, they were down by one-goal deficit. So that's sort of how that first goal really set the series. And I do think that if that goal had been, if Briere had been called offsides, as he should have been, that was an easy Penguins victory.
I gotta say, having really not watched the game, you still should have won that game. You can't give up four unanswered goals in the playoffs at home.
Yeah, but when something that's so blatantly bullshit happens to your team...
You're telling me if you're a champion, you can't recover from that? So one goal that happens, that's BS? You can't somehow go, all right, well, you know what, we still have a two-goal lead.
No. I'm blaming the entire series on that fucking goal. On that
you can't then go
game.
Into
I don't
games
know his name,
two,
but
three,
I'm
four,
look
and
it
go,
up.
Hey, these are new games. You're still thinking about Briere 8 feet offside?
Yeah.
So when Crosby's going nuts and just starts attacking people, and everybody on the Penguins apparently is on PCP and meth, and they just go insane for about three or four games picking up penalties, it's really because the refs missed that first goal.
It's because everyone who went crazy and apeshit on the Penguins bench, they were projecting that onto the Flyers, but they wanted to be fucking up that linesman for blowing the first game for them. I mean, when you blow a game one at home like that, and you're the favorite to win the East, you gotta blame something. But after that, the defense completely collapsed and had no fucking confidence the rest of the series. And Philadelphia was able to get into their heads, and it was all because of that huge lead that was blown in the second period, thanks to some asshole linesman who shouldn't be in the fucking NHL.
Rez, could you please jump in here and hopefully...
Yeah, I'm going to have to disagree with you on this, Matt. as much as I would like to just blame the whole debacle of, you know, the first games of that series on one call, I think Jason's right that you got to... A championship team's got to bounce back from that and pull it together. And there's enough that went wrong that you can't say, well, that was because it... I mean, I think it definitely changed the series, and you know, bad calls happen, and championship teams have to take them in stride and buckle down, and, you know, the Penguins, assuming it was all from that call that caused them to lose their minds for three games, like, that's not an excuse.
More importantly, the Flyers are going to lose to the Devils, and so I'm pretty happy about that. But it is hard being a current citizen of Philadelphia to fucking, like, show my face in public here right now. It's not fun. And I just want to point out, Rez, that while you disagreed with me, you also said that, yes, the Penguins would have won in Game 7 had that call gone their way, the right way.
Right.
So something like that can really throw them off kilt. And at the same time, really pump up the Flyers to be like, holy shit, you know, we got Fleury's number. We can come back from anything. We got the defense's number. Yeah, they can score a lot of goals, but we're going to just dismantle their defense and their goaltender and score more. And we know we can do that now.
My disagreement with you isn't that it was a big factor, maybe even a deciding factor, but you prefaced this whole thing by saying it was the factor. And certainly Letang, Malkin, Fleury, Paul Martin, Bilesma, there's quite a bit of blame to go around.
You guys really have it out for Paul Martin.
Well, the three games that they scratched him, we won two of them. The third one we lost. Let's talk about your team a little bit here.
Oh, God.
You
guys at least had an exciting series.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, if you like a lot of fucking bad goals, but... I mean, like, your team fell to the Blues, correct?
Yes.
Who just systematically got completely shit upon by the number 8 seed just now.
And your boy Mike Richards.
Quit it.
he's on his way to a Stanley
Cup. What kind of numbers is he bringing up, putting up?
Yeah, let me tell you real quick. Yeah. I'll look it up. Keep talking, I'll look it up.
Okay, we'll keep talking. But Rez, you're in the LA area. What is the whole vibe going on there? I mean, I know that they're really only in love with the Lakers out there.
It's definitely like a basketball city. Basketball and baseball are pretty close. So the Kings are sort of adding to like the vibe that this is just a great time for sports in LA because you have the Lakers and the Clippers both doing well in the playoffs. The Dodgers have the best record in
the
National League.
Wait, the Clippers are in the playoffs?
Yeah, the Clippers are good this year.
Fucking ain't. How's that happen, Jason?
They got good players now. They made a trade.
Whatever happened to the Golden State?
We're still working on it. We're still rebuilding. Okay. We're only in the 18th year of the rebuilding plan. it's a 20-year plan.
Okay. Well.
All right. So you ready for Richard's numbers real quick? 9 games, he's got 8 points, 3 goals, 5 assists.
Okay. Fair enough. So, Rez, continue.
So the Kings are like...
Are there a lot of flaggets? Are there a lot of Kings flaggets?
No Kings flaggets. The Kings are a nice footnote to this whole, like, hey, it's a great time for sports in L.A., but they're being overshadowed by the Dodgers and Lakers and somewhat by the Clippers.
Okay. Well, take what
he's one of the legends, according to EA.
That fucking guy. How fucked up is it going to be if there's a L.A.-Philadelphia final?
Who are you going to root for?
Al-Qaeda to blow it up.
Come on. You got to root for Rob Scuderi.
I know, but I hate Mike Richards so much and somewhat Jeff Carter that I don't know. I can't. I'm honestly rooting for the Coyotes. I think that's a great story of like the ugly stepchild that nobody wants. That city doesn't even want them. And yet they're like fucking good, and they're a complete team, and they have great goaltending. So I'm really rooting for them to win the cup.
Well, here's my problematic relationship with the LA Kings, is that you know I still root for Pittsburgh teams first and foremost, but I've been trying to get like more and more into the LA sports scene as I've gotten settled here. And Rob Scuderi was one of my favorite Penguins, so I like that the Kings signed him. And, you know, my roots go back to Slovenia, and Andrej Kopitar is the greatest Slovenian athlete in the world.
He's the only Slovenian athlete.
No, there's some good basketball players.
Whatever.
But then I went to they signed those Flyers, which wasn't good. And then I went to a Kings-Penguins game earlier this year. And to fire up the crowd before the game, they showed the clip of Van Damme beating up Iceberg. And so that left a very sour taste in my mouth.
Yeah. That's Bush League right there. That's a low blow.
Hey, let me ask you guys a question. This will be the brief Sharks moment.
Okay.
Because obviously they went down in flames to a team that just got annihilated by the Kings. They're too old. They're over the hill. They need to rebuild.
Right.
Would you guys replace any of the Penguins, like, line for line with any of the Sharks guys? Like, if you had an opportunity, would you, like, replace, say, like, you know, Staal with Couture, anything like that?
Considering that Staal is unhappy and wants to get out, then, yeah, I might say Staal with Couture. Because Couture is younger, right?
But this is what I'm saying. It's like, the Sharks, I don't know if they're as talented as they are thought of. You know what I mean?
I'll tell you what I would replace. I would give you Brooks Orpik and Paul Martin for one Danny Boyle. Seriously.
You say it like I can make it happen. No, seriously, I want to make that.
Well, can't you? I mean, shit. That would be awesome. I mean, to get someone like Danny Boyle on the team who would be like Gonchar was all those years.
Would you take Gonch?
Back? No.
Yeah.
No. He sucks defensively.
So I didn't follow the Sharks that closely throughout the season. Like, what was the reason for them going dropping from being a perennial, you know, 1-2 seed to being a 7? Was there personnel differences or just age or
right off the top of my head, I'm going to go top three things. These are all don't you say it. These are all bullshit. But I'll go number one, the penalty kill is awful. I think they were like 30th in the league or something. They're terrible. They can't really score 5-on-5. They're a terrible 5-on-5 offensive team. They can only really score on the power play. And their best players never seem to actually perform like top players in the playoffs. They just never do. At least if you're a Penguins fan, you can sort of rest your hat on, like, you know, Malkin's going to do something. You know, Crosby's going to do something. They at least
Malkin
scored.
Didn't do shit.
Marlowe didn't have a point.
Oh well, he never has. That guy sucks. But I'd chuck it off to Danny fucking Heatley.
To the Brent Burns Heatley trade.
Yeah, I mean, what did you get out of that? Did you get anything out of Heatley Setoguchi going to Minnesota?
Well, we got Brent Burns, and he didn't play that well defensively.
Brent Burns sounds like some fucking, like,
he was an all-star
second baseman for some fucking shitty baseball team. Like, who is Brent Burns? Huh?
Are you drinking?
I've drinked past tense and present tense, yes.
But before we get to this goal, I know this is a fresh wound, but are you ready to say that as of right now, Claude Giroux is the best player in the NHL?
No, I'm not gonna say that. No. No, they're not gonna win a cup, and I feel like same argument with Ovechkin, like. You can say all day long till you're blue in the face that he's the best player in the league, but if you can't lead a team to the victory, then you're not. And Giroux's not going to get that cup, not this year at least, and neither is Ovechkin, so...
Hey, did you guys make it out of the second round 2 years ago?
Yeah, that's when Montreal beat us.
In the first round, right?
No, that was the second round.
Yeah, they beat the Capitals in the first round.
It sucked because we were the number one seed in the second round. Like, you know, everything opened up because number one, two, and three got knocked out, and we were fourth. And then, yeah, the fucking Calamari and Halleck, who apparently sucks now and can't fucking beat the Kings.
I gotta tell you, Rez, I'm sorry that this is the episode you're guesting on because... Matt, I you sound pretty depressed.
Well, I wasn't until like I had to start until you brought this shit up, man. And then like
you told me you wanted to talk about it.
I got my fucking hometown boy here online, and he's telling me that I'm wrong, that the Penguins deserve to lose.
No,
here's what happened.
Yada yada
to say
yada.
That.
Fucking Yager and Talbot. Blah blah blah.
What are you talking about?
I want to just go out on I just want to say
said anything about Talbot.
I want to state for the record that I'm going to wipe my ass with my autographed Talbot hat tonight, but also also I think it's bullshit. You know, not only is the Briere goal the biggest bullshit goal ever, and Jason, you'll see it when I air the episode cuz I'll be sure to put that on there. But secondly, another piece of bullshit is the whole fucking playoff seeding process. How, yeah. Like, the fucking Penguins had the second highest points in the East, and yet they're pushed down to fourth fucking place because these assholes in these shitty divisions. You know, you got four teams from the Atlantic Division in the fucking playoffs, and it was a great division this year. And then, yet, you know, the Penguins being the second highest point total in the East get pushed down to fourth and get this shitty lineup with Philadelphia. I hate
playing
that.
Playing the third highest point total, correct?
Exactly, yeah. So like it would have made for better matchups. Well, not better matchups, but you know, not for better like viewing matchups, but still, like the Penguins deserve to play whoever the fuck the seventh seed was.
Who would you have played, the Capitals?
Yeah, I guess.
Could have been a tough one too.
We never lose to the Capitals in the playoffs.
Yeah, they look really bad, by the way, but that's another podcast. So, okay, it's been forever since we had some bullshit on here. And for whatever one or two viewers we have left, we present to you some pretty good bullshit here. And this was a matchup in-house between Rez and I.
One thing I should say before we get into this is I think that this goal that everyone's about to see is in part bad karma for me just being a jerk and choosing to go color on color with the jerseys to confuse everybody.
This was in Phoenix, so yeah, you were playing the blue jerseys. But I just, okay, just to clarify here, this goal was scored in overtime. It was 18 minutes into overtime, and yeah, so it was the game-winning goal. I got it in overtime, 18 minutes in. And there's the bullshit. So the shot, I took the shot. I don't know, I must have been on the penalty kill, because I slapped it from my own fucking goal line. Down, hit the end boards, and Kabe Bulin, being the perennial drunkard that he is, watches this puck come off the end boards and fumbles with it and manages to kick it into the net himself.
Wait, so you were the Oilers?
I was the Oilers.
Rez was the Oilers, I was the Coyotes, okay?
Oh, so why are you unhappy about this?
Who said I was unhappy about it? You just fucking project unhappiness on me all the time. You're like fucking Tebow, fucking Briere, you're unhappy. What the fuck, man?
Did you say Tebow?
No, I didn't. Let's not bring that up.
Didn't you say Tebow Briere?
I might have said Tebow Briere. I'm unhappy, yes.
I think just your tone sounds so unhappy that I'm like, I threw it off the boards.
Okay, I'll retake it. So I slapped it from my own fucking goal line, and this son of a bitch just watches it off the end boards, and that dumb bastard trips over the own puck because he's fucking drunk like he always is, and he kicks it in his own net. Game over.
And you guys were seated next to each other during this, right?
Correct.
Was there, Rez, at any moment, was there sort of like the hesitation where you're like, well, this game just doesn't count?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's over. It's not like I hit reset at that point. But yeah, I mean, that's still my feeling to this day, is that I don't see, if it were to count for anything, then it should be discount. No, it shouldn't count.
What?
I don't know what it does count for.
I don't know what's happening during this report.
It was just a game.
Well, you just caused Matt to have like 8 more PBR.
Okay.
I don't know what it would count for to start with, but if it were to count for anything, it should not count because of how it ended.
First of all, we no longer plug PBR here because I'm a home brewer. Okay.
Sorry.
What's going on over there? So don't plug PBR anymore. I brew my own. And second of all, Rez, the reason why you're confused is that you may or may not have known that, but Jason and I keep a book. It's called The Book, right?
Yeah, I found it, by the way.
Oh, you found it? Oh, very good. So we have a book dating back
2.5 years worth of playing.
Yeah, and so we record every victory. Who won, what teams were involved, and who the three stars were. And if, on a rare occasion, like one of us may or may not call it a complete bullshit game, based upon some of the goals like you might have seen here tonight or in that first game with the Penguins Flyers, we may or may not leave a comment and there will be an asterisk involved. Is that right, Jason?
Sometimes. It's only on the most bullshit of bullshit games.
Can you give us an example of a bullshit game?
Well, these aren't necessarily bullshit goals, but I think I remember when we used to play on, I want to say, did we start on 9?
Yeah, on the Xbox. No, we started on 10 on PS3, and then I think you went and got 9 for the Xbox.
So on Xbox, on NHL 9, I think at one point, and that was the most bullshit version of the game, but I think I was maybe up like 7-2 or something in a game, and you, I think you scored
I pulled a Flyers, yeah.
You scored something like 5 or 6 goals with Hempstead, and I remember that definitely got a notation, because you wouldn't shut the fuck up about the game, and it was all on those one-timer shots.
Oh,
so I
yeah,
had to...
yeah, I scored like 7 goals with Hemschke. Yeah.
Even though at no point during any of those goals could you actually see Hemschke in the frame on TV when you were taking a shot.
Yeah, because we had it wasn't a widescreen TV, it was a CRT, and so yeah, you'd pass it over and I'd just have to assume that my player was over there. And the fucking puck would be out of frame, off screen, and then I would fucking score, which also apparently confused your goaltender.
Yeah.
But yes, that's what he meant by...
I see.
If it counted for anything. But yes, yeah, so, I mean, here we have a case of another case of, I don't know, Cobby Bullen strikes again, pretty much.
Well, I mean, as the puck is coming towards him...
Yeah.
Off the board, like there are many things he could do for it to not be a goal.
Not even approach the puck. Yeah.
Well, yeah, he could skate the fuck away, and it would just harmlessly slide by the front of the goal. He could knock it away with his blocker. He could bend over and pick it up. He could advance on it and block it. The only way that becomes a goal is for him to stand in the exact position he was and do nothing.
You know, I wasn't involved in this game, so it's difficult for me to pass judgments on the players involved. But I blame the other Oilers and not Nikolai. Because, as you said, Matt, he does have a history with substance abuse. And if you're going to allow a teammate to go through that without saying something, that's on you. They should have sat him down and said, hey, you're not playing it.
And there's got to be someone whose job it is to check that water bottle before the game.
So, okay, let's rate this son of a bitch.
I'm going to give it an 8.
An 8? Only an 8?
Because we've seen computer goalies in this game do all kinds of ridiculous shit. I'm surprised considering the game that he doesn't skate to the other end of the ice and give the Coyotes goalie a high five.
We've seen Cobby Bullen do this shit over and over again. I mean, for a Cobby Bullen goal, this is like a 4.
Well, oh, so that's why you were upset with me. Too high.
No. I'm just, you know, in the grand scheme of bullshitness, being that the Briere goal is a 10, right?
Oh, Jesus.
No, it has to be. It's a... Hey, listen, Jason, you give the highest ratings for goals that are illegal. Am I wrong? Am I wrong?
Yes, yeah.
I'm wrong.
I would say you are correct.
Okay, well, that was one of the most blatant illegal goals ever in the history of the NHL playoffs. So that's a 10. And we don't give 10s unless it's completely just illegal. Someone fucked up the call. So this goal, it wasn't illegal at all. It was just this guy's drunk. And he trips over the puck. So, I got to say, if it was any other goalie other than Cobby Bullen, I'd almost say 10. But it's Cobby Bullen, so I'm going to agree with you and go with an 8.
Did you just do like a 180 in your scoring? Where at one point you said because it's Cobby Bullen, it's a 4, and then at the end of your ramble, you said because it's Hobby Bull and it's an 8?
No, I was just joking about the 4. But I like the look on the face of 44, whoever the fuck that son of a bitch is. He just like skates up behind him. He's like, what the fuck?
Well, and one of the great parts of this goal that we haven't talked about yet is that, you know, Cobby Bullen stands like a statue watching the puck come off the board when basically any activity would have prevented it from being a goal.
Right.
Instead, he just stands there, does nothing until after it's crossed the goal line, and then he freaks the fuck out.
Yeah, right here. I don't know if you guys can see, but
I can see it.
The puck, you can see where the puck is right near the goal line, right behind his leg. And then he, like, all of a sudden squats, swoops down. And that's what projects the puck into the net. And then he acts like he's been, like, fucking shot or something. He pulls a fucking,
What if his Achilles exploded?
I guess so. I don't know. It's more like his fucking, like, spinal cord was ripped out of his body the way he reacts.
Oh, well, you know, I've been watching a lot of those Predator, like Alien versus Predator movies lately. A Predator could have been on the ice and just gone invisible mode.
So that's what Father is like. You get to watch a lot of Predator versus Alien.
Yeah.
What is it, AVP?
That's that's the one.
There's only one? Okay, so you've just watched one movie several thousand times since having a child. Is that what you're saying?
Since we've broken this goal, then I got to ask you guys something. If this goal had been the first goal that occurred in the Flyers Penguins series when you were up 3-0, would this still have determined the downfall of the series for the Penguins? Would this have been bullshit enough? Could the Penguins have overcome this if this had been the first goal scored?
No, because it would have meant that Fleury's back into his ways of last season where he was letting in softies.
So you're still saying, even, I mean, this goal ended your game because you were in OT, but you're saying a goal like this against a normal team with, you know, the second most points in the East, you just can't come back from that, even though you're only in, like, the second period.
No, because it means that your goaltender's either fucked up on fucking Stolichnaya or doesn't deserve to be in the NHL in the first place, so you're not coming back from this.
For, like, 3-4 games, you just can't compose yourself.
No, because your backup goaltender just got out of rehab, so you can't trust him either.
Allegedly.
I don't think it would demoralize the entire team the same way the Briere goal did, but it would be solely on one player. It would just be the goalie completely fucking up, and then it would be whether he was able to bounce back or not.
Yeah.
I don't think it would cause the whole team to lose its mind like the Penguins did.
You're absolutely right. Like, I mean, can you imagine if Fleury had let in this goal, what was going on in his mind? Versus if Fleury let in the Briere goal, whereas like the whole team is like, what the fuck? Like, the universe is against us.
You know, Matt, since you're in Pennsylvania, can
yes.
you do me and this one Briere goal has caused such a, you know, a hotbed of conversation over here. Can you maybe travel down to Dingbats, maybe get the pulse of the locals and see what they thought about that goal?
There ain't no Dingbats in Philly, first of all. So
I don't think there are Dingbats anywhere anymore.
Yeah, you're living in the '90s, man.
I thought you had one in your hometown.
Nah, they're taking that out. They're putting in a different restaurant.
Jeez. No more Dingbats.
You lost your chance to fucking visit and go to Dingbats. I know you were excited about that.
Well, gentlemen, is there anything else?
Well, I'd like to say go Devils, and
they're up right now.
Oh, good. It sucks that the Penguins, with this team that they had here, which was pretty amazing, except for maybe some of the defense, it sucks that the season ended the way it did. And I'm afraid that it's not, you know, they're not going to get there again. It's almost like, to me, I'm a little nervous it's going to turn into like Tampa Bay after they won the Cup. And it's like you got LeCavier and St. Louis on the team, but they're not what they used to be. So we'll see. Like, we'll see if Crosby gets back to 100%. I definitely don't think he was playing 100% this season at all. even in the playoffs. So he just looked out of it. But
I'm interested from the both of you real quick, because I'll have to go in a second. Stanley Cup champion.
Coyotes, all the way. Go Coyotes.
Red.
Fuck, I don't like any of the teams left. Devils.
Thank you.
All right, and that about wraps it up here. Thanks for bearing with us over these last 4 or so months. We want to thank Jason for all the downtime here, being a new father.
God, this was such a depressing episode. I'm sorry that people had to listen to this.
You're sorry that you had to... What do you mean?
The three people that were excited to maybe like go like, oh my God, they actually put up a new episode. As soon as they click on and get to this point, it's got to be like sitting through what was that, the Vietnam movie?
Well, unless they're fans of one of the, you know, handful of teams that are still there, the hockey fans should be depressed right now.
Yeah, I agree. All hockey fans, especially our Canadian viewers, should be very depressed right now.
And I feel bad for the one, like...
It's a dark time.
What about the one, like, 9 or 10-year-old BS Goals fan that we actually have that was so excited about today's action and they're going to be listening to our episode wearing a Mike Richards jersey, and then they got to just hear you talk crazy shit about their favorite player about 10 minutes.
Hey, what's right is right.
They're in tears. They're listening to a man that may or may not be intoxicated talk about one goal, the first goal being scored in a 60-goal series being the goal that ended the Penguins' playoff run. They got to hear you talk shit
There's
about
no Benson's other fucking explanation.
Structure.
This team was they were fucking – everyone had them to win.
You said it was the worst matchup they could have possibly ever had.
It was. If they had beaten the Flyers, I guaranteed a cup win.
I agree.
I agree. Yeah, if we had just gotten out of the first round, there was nobody that could beat us.
Exactly.
But that one offsides goal, it sent us into a tailspin we could never recover from.
Exactly.
And it was Paul Martin's fault.
I think so. There's probably a 95% chance that he was involved in some way or another. Anyway.
I agree.
Anyway, congratulations to Jason on his newly found fatherhood.
Thank you.
And hopefully we'll get to play some games here soon.
I'd like to propose something to you, gentlemen.
I can play. Yeah, propose away.
If, I've never done this before, but a coworker of mine is a big NHL 12 fan and was actually kind of interested in our podcast when he found out about it. And apparently him and his buddies play league games where they all have set positions and they play against other guys. If you guys are interested in becoming a team and squaring off against them, could be kind of interesting.
We can try it. I think we're like 4 men short, though.
It's okay. We can play with computer players.
It'd be cool to have like a BS Goals team.
If you're an actual listener, I doubt you're out there, but if you are, please let us know via comment or Twitter at BS Goals if you're interested in joining the team.
I'm not playing with any punk 9-year-old in a Mike Richards jersey, though.
I feel so bad for this kid. This fictional kid out there right now.
Okay, so I guess that's about it. We should wrap it up here and thank our 9-year-old Mike Richards fan for tuning in here after such a long hiatus. And we do hope to come back sooner or later and have another BS Goal for you, but we're running low on content, so please bear with us.
And if we learned anything, kids, from tonight's episode is the first time you face adversity in anything you do, there's no way to overcome it. There's just no way.
And we also learned that alcohol can ruin your life.
What? That is so sad. That sounded so sad.
All right.
What is going on in that apartment?
Yeah, I don't know. But good night, everyone.
Good night.